Hello, Students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker with a new chapter, a new topic. Today we're going to talk about Newtonian kinetics of rigid bodies. Now, this is a topic that we've talked about before, but not for rigid bodies, but for particles. So remembering back to our Newtonian kinetics for particles, we used the following equation. Based upon Newton's second law, we said sum of forces as a vector is equal to mass times acceleration as a vector. We didn't need to worry about what acceleration we're talking about. It was just the acceleration of the particle. And accelerations didn't vary by location on a particle because all the mass was condensed down to one little place. But now for rigid bodies, we need to make a slight edit to that first equation. Sum of forces, same thing on the left. On the right-hand side is mass times a bar vector. Okay, anytime you see this bar in the remainder of dynamics, this will mean either of or about the centroid. Remember those centroids we learned how to find back in statics? Here's where that's going to come into play. We're going to be able to locate those locations and essentially use the acceleration of that centroidal point. Now, there is a second equation that we need because of rotation. Okay, the first equation takes care of translation. The rotational equation tells us that sum of moments as a vector. In statics, this equals zero. In dynamics, it equals I times alpha, where alpha is the vector. Now, we don't need to have an alpha bar here just because alpha is constant for an entire rotating body. So what is this term I? It turns out that this term I is our mass moment of inertia. Now, I want to highlight here the difference between mass moment of inertia and area moment of inertia because they are not the same thing. Okay, so mass moment of inertia and area moment of inertia. Confusingly, they use the same variable. I don't love that fact, but it is true. Both of them need to be about some kind of a point or an axis, so they both have a subscript. The mass moment of inertia is defined as the resistance to rotation. And the area moment of inertia could be defined as the distribution of area in a cross section. Which is then directly related to cross-sectional stiffness. So it should make sense that area moment of inertia is used in statics and solids, or mechanics of solids, or mechanics of materials also, and our mass moment of inertia is used in dynamics. The two terms and the computation of either area moment of inertia or mass moment of inertia are really, really similar. Really, the main difference is, and it shows up here in the name, for area moments of inertia, we tend to use areas and distances. For mass moments of inertia, we tend to use masses and distances. Otherwise, things are very, very much the same. So there are equations here, continuing now for our mass moment of inertia. We have our fundamental integral equation tells us that our moment of inertia, I, is equal to the integral of r squared, where r is the distance from our axes of interest over to an element on that body, which we could say is dm, okay, a little differential mass. And so if we had a three-dimensional object here and we extracted from that a little cube, and let's say we were interested in the moment of inertia about this particular y-axis right here, we could identify a distance r over to that little mass to figure out the moment of inertia about this given axis. Now, if your density is constant, we could actually factor density out of mass and write the following integral. So I is equal to rho, which is our constant density, times the integral, still our r squared. Now this is going to be dv, where v is the volume. Okay, so you could run these integrals. You could do double integrals, triple integrals, single integrals. It all just kind of depends on the shape of your differential volume, differential area, strip, circle, whatever that's going to be. Now, because the integrals and the double and triple integrals are covered so solidly in calculus, I'm going to focus the remainder of this video and our focus in dynamics on composite bodies and how we can start with a chart of moments of inertia, mass moments of inertia, and then combine those and look at the composite body moment of inertia around various axes. Okay, so in order to do that, we're going to use what's called the parallel axis theorem. And the parallel axis theorem is the following. We can say that the moment of inertia about some desired axis is equal to the moment of inertia about the centroid, that bar above I, plus our mass times our distance squared. Okay, so to define these various terms, we can say that our I about our axis is defined as our mass, moment of inertia, I'll use MOI, about the desired axis. We can say that our I bar again is our mass, moment of inertia about the centroidal axes parallel to the desired axis. And the last term there in our list we have is d squared, which is the distance between the centroid to the desired axis. And if you learned in statics about x tilde or y tilde, we can also use r depending on what kind of a distance we're talking about. These are talking about that same distance from the centroid to the desired axes as an overall distance. And so just to draw a picture of what that might look like, let's say that we have a cube as our shape, our mass. And we want to find the moment inertia of this mass about this y-axis. So our d value would be the distance from the y-axis over to the centroid. We typically label centroids with the letter g, of that mass, and so this would be our d. Now the centroidal axis that we're talking about here is also going to be a, we'll call this our y prime axis, parallel to y, but also going through the centroid. And so fundamentally, if you could find the moment inertia for this shape over here, then you could transfer that moment inertia from the centroid over to a different axis. Now noting when you transfer them, as we take a look at this parallel axis theorem transfer term, we have a mass, and all masses are going to be positive as long as it's not a hole cut out of something. I'll talk more about that as we move forward. But basically, if you have a positive mass, that's going to translate into a positive term here. And the distance is going to be squared. So it wouldn't matter if you moved your axes to the right of the shape or to the left of the shape. You don't need to worry about negative distances because we're going to square that term. Okay, so any of those negatives would go away. One other thing I wanted to talk about before I moved on from this drawing is what happens if we want to find the moment of inertia about the x-axis. Okay, so it turns out that we need to use a different centroidal moment of inertia. So that centroidal moment of inertia would be about this x prime axis. And then a third different axis that this could be about, if you think about there being a z-axis, which is coming out of the screen toward you, watch out. Then we're looking at a third axis, which is essentially coming out of the screen here. We could call this z prime. Okay, so a given shape can actually have different moments of inertia depending on about which axes we are discussing. So if we were going to use this same idea, now instead of worrying about just a single mass, let's talk about using the parallel axis theorem for a composite body. Okay, and a composite body is made up of individual subshapes, and we're assuming that these individual subshapes each have a known mass moment of inertia. So we could say our moment of inertia about some axis is equal to the sum, we're going to sum up, put a little note here, for each subshape, sum of each subshape. And we're going to write the same equation here for the parallel axis theorem. That's going to be the I bar of each subshape plus the MD squared. So the mass of each subshape times the distance of the centroid of that subshape over to our desired axes. Okay, so a couple of notes here. We can say that all moments of inertia of positive masses are positive. We talked a little bit about that with the distance squared, mass being squared. A second point we can make here is that the moment of inertia through the centroid is the smallest possible because you can't get smaller than a moment of inertia through the centroid. It only gets bigger as you move away around other axes. And that should make sense. You could think about it's easiest to spin, say, a basketball. If you spin it through, like on your finger, through the middle axes, it gets harder to rotate that basketball if you hold it out on the end of your arms and you spin your body around. Now your body becomes the axis of rotation. So it gets harder to rotate that basketball the further it gets from that axis. And then point number three to make is that cutout areas. So we'll say cutout volumes slash masses result in a negative both the I bar of whatever that cutout shape is and our mass M. Okay, so if you have a cutout shape, basically what it's saying is that both this term and this term in our composite body equation will turn out to be negative for that cutout shape. That's essentially if you've drilled a hole in something or you have a void in your overall mass. All right, two other ideas I'd like to cover in this lecture. One of those ideas is related to what's called the radius of gyration. And radius of gyration uses small letter k as its variable name. And then radius of gyration is always about some kind of an axis, just like our moment of inertia is always about an axis. And this idea of a radius of gyration is essentially based upon the idea. And the idea of a radius of gyration is essentially gives us a term where we can collapse the mass moment of inertia and the mass into one single term. Okay, and so I'll show you what the equation is, and we'll talk a little bit more fundamentally how it can be used. And so we can say that K about our desired axis is equal to a square root of our moment of inertia about the same axis divided by the mass of that body. Okay, so if we have an axis system, let's go with, again, a y-axis up, x-axis horizontal here. Go ahead and draw our z-axis coming toward you. And let's say over here on our coordinate system, we have a mass. Okay, and think of this as a three-dimensional mass, which is just kind of sitting out there in space. So as we think about this radius of gyration, we can think about it a couple different ways. One way is we can think about that if we wanted to find the radius of gyration around the y-axis, we could take this mass and we could roll it or extrude it into a very thin, very long, very small radius cylinder. And so this would have the same mass as our original. And not only would it have the same mass, but it would also have the same moment of inertia about that y-axis, given that this distance from the y-axis over to that mass is going to be my k. All right, this is k sub y, right? My moment of inertia about the y-axis. So we could also take a look, if you wanted to, about the moment of inertia, say, about the z-axis. Now, conceptualizing the z-axis as coming out of the page, you can actually think about taking this mass. Now we're assuming this mass is ductile, right? So you can think about it as a big lump of clay or of putty. And you could actually form a cylinder of that same mass basically around this z-axis. Okay, so this is intended to show here that the z-axis is coming right through the middle. And if that cylinder has the same mass, it turns out that its radius from the middle out here, we could call k sub z. Okay, so we either form things into a thin rod or into a thin cylinder, but the basic idea is that the radius of gyration is the radius to a body with all mass concentrated at k of the axis and the body having the same mass and moment of inertia, MOI, as the original. Now, practically, you're never going to take a steel I-beam and melt it down into a very thin rod and then put it out at some radius to make all this true. But the cool thing about our moments of inertia and our mass together in one single term is that it makes a lot of analysis and look up in different tables quite a bit easier as you move forth in either your structural engineering classes or possibly in your machine design classes. One place it can be used specifically is to simplify structural engineering calculations like column sizing when you're worried about which direction the column might buckle when it's in compression. Okay, so you might see that moving forward in some of your classes. The last topic that I wanted to cover before the end of this video is the idea of centers of percussion. So a center of percussion, and we use a distance for the center of percussion, which is the small letter Q. So the center of percussion, if you've ever played any baseball, any tennis, anything else, you might have heard this term before, or at least you've heard of the sweet spot. And in more words, this is the point at which an impact produces no reactive shock at the pivot. So if you're hitting a baseball with a baseball bat, and as you swing at that ball, and the ball hits right on the sweet spot, right at the center percussion, you feel the least amount of vibration through your hands, and you actually get the most amount of energy or power transfer from the bat into the ball. And so it feels like you just swing through the ball, and it sails farther than you ever thought you could hit it. Another place that we use the sweet spot or center percussion is in the design of hammers. So if you think about a hammer, and this is a really simplified drawing, and we think about that we hold it out here at the end, call this point O, this is our pivot. And there's two different points we could locate out here. One of these would be the centroid, right, or the center of mass, and the other one is going to be the center of percussion. Now we can also use the COP for the center percussion, just like we use MOI for moments of inertia. And in a hammer, it turns out that we want these as close together as possible. Okay, you want them close together, essentially so as you're striking something, that you don't end up with any vibration coming back through your hand, which is the pivot. So the equation to find this center percussion turns out to be that this distance Q, now I'm going to write this as Q about point O. So basically this center percussion is measured from the pivot, and I'll write that down as a note, but Q naught is equal to my moment of inertia about the same axis, my pivot, divided by the mass times Y bar. Okay, so coming back over to our hammer here, we could show that the distance from the pivot to the centroid is Y bar. The distance out to the center percussion is going to be Q naught. And this would use the mass of the overall hammer, not just the mass of the head. It would be the overall mass of this system. A side note here to measure both Y bar and Q from the pivot point. You could also think the center percussion could be used if you were designing some kind of a rotary hammer that's going to have a continuous or kind of an episodic rotational striking of, maybe it's a column striking of a certain material, whatever else it's going to be. If you design that rotational hammer to have its impact hitting right at the center percussion, it's actually going to give you the least amount of wear back at your pivot point, right? Back at fundamentally what would be a bearing. And so you can minimize your mechanical wear at that bearing by making sure it's always striking either at or really close to that center percussion. Now, it turns out you can never collapse your center of percussion and your centroid into one location, but you can get them really close to each other, which is often what we want to do. Thank you for your attention today, and hope you learned a little bit more about mass moments of inertia, centers of percussion, and also radiuses of gyration. Hope you're having a great day.